Blessed be the one holy and living God. May God be with you. Let us pray together. O God, you have taught us to keep all your commandments by loving you and our neighbor. Grant us the grace of your Holy Spirit that we may be devoted to you with our whole heart and united to one another with pure affection through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
A reading from Isaiah. Thus says the Lord, rejoice with Jerusalem and be glad for her, all you who love her. Rejoice with her in joy, all you who mourn over her, that you may nurse and be satisfied with her consoling breast, that you may drink deeply with delight from her glorious bosom. For thus says the Lord, I will extend prosperity to her like a river, and the wealth of nations like an overflowing stream. And you shall nurse and be carried on her arm and dandled on her knees. As a mother comforts her child, so I will comfort you. You shall be comforted in Jerusalem. You shall see, and your heart shall rejoice. Your bodies shall flourish like the grass. And it shall be known that the hand of the Lord is with his servants, and his indignation is against his enemies. The word of God.
Let's read the first part of Psalm 66 together. Be joyful in God, all you lands. Sing the glory of God's name.
A reading from Galatians. My friends, if anyone is detected in a transgression, you who have received the Spirit should restore such a one in a spirit of gentleness. Take care that you yourselves are not tempted. Bear one another's burdens, and in this way you will fulfill the law of Christ. For those who are nothing think they are something. They deceive themselves. All must test their own work. then that work, rather than their neighbor's work, will become a case for pride, for all must carry their own loads. Those who are taught the word must share in all good things with their teacher. Do not be deceived. God is not mocked, for you reap whatever you sow. If you sow to your own flesh, you will reap corruption from the flesh. But if you sow to the Spirit, you will reap eternal life from the Spirit. So let us not grow weary in doing what is right, for we will reap at harvest time if we do not give up. So then, whenever we have an opportunity, let us work for the good of all, and especially for those of the family of faith. See what large letters I make when I am writing in my own hand. It is those who want to make a good showing in the flesh that try to compel you to be circumcised, only that they may not be persecuted for the cross of Christ. Even the circumcised do not themselves obey the law, but they want you to be circumcised so that they may boast about your flesh. May I never boast of anything except the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, by which the world has been crucified to me, and I to the world. For neither circumcision nor uncircumcision is anything, but a new creation is everything. As for those who will follow this rule, peace be upon them and mercy, and upon the Israel of God. The word of the Lord.
Thank you. the gospel of the Lord.
Bless our God, you peoples. Make the voice of God's praise be heard, who holds our souls in life and will not allow our feet to slip. Amen. Morning. It's a goodly crowd for a 4th of July weekend. Nice to see all of you. I have once again written a titled sermon, that St. Martin's thing. So I thought I'd share the title with you so you'll know what you're gonna hear. The title of this sermon is, Do Your Ears Hang Low? There, good. When I was a boy and July like this came round, my sister and I, who lived up in the Virginia mountains, most summers were carried to my mother's ancestral home in George, North Carolina. Yes, you heard that right, George. George was a tiny but prosperous village of Quaker folk perched in the northeastern corner of the coastal plains of North Carolina. Just like Fanny Flagg's novel and movie, Fried Green Tomatoes, this town had a railroad running through it, exactly like, you may remember if you saw that movie, a railroad ran through that little town in Fried Green Tomatoes. And it was that railroad that made possible the prosperity of the little town. It ferried materials for the local industries, and Aunt Alexis will like this. There were five casket factories in this little town. Quakers, I guess, were good at caskets, and there was always a demand, and box factories. So the trains came into town with materials to make caskets and boxes, and then went on their way up north full of caskets and boxes to carry whatever they carried up there, as we called the north, up there. My great-grandfather, for whom the village was named, his name was George Harrison Parker. He married, he had children, among them my grandfather. He was widowed. He married again, this time a widow, who brought her children to the marriage, and eventually two of those children, one from each marriage, lest you worry, themselves were married. And these were my grandfather, who died young, and my grandmother, Mama Ruth, who, widowed in 1924 by the remains of the influenza pandemic, raised six small children in a house on a farm beside that railroad and the little depot that served it. And it was to this farmhouse and this farm that we decamped each summer, there to run barefoot and nearly naked with our two dozen cousins and the boys and girls from the neighboring African-American farm owners through the fields and woods of neighboring yards in George. Beyond that, we interracial friendships could not go. We were told early that we were not to fraternize with our black neighbors beyond the boundaries of our farm, lest we cause harm to come to our friends. And so we did not. And so for a week each July, We all set out each morning and walked about a mile or so east on the gritty shoulder of the newly paved highway to the nearest larger town, Woodland, and the local school, Woodland Alney, which had been founded as a more or less public institution by my Quaker ancestors, who were firm believers in the value of education and of the importance of words. There we attended Vacation Bible School. Each morning, we gathered in the school auditorium, take that, Supreme Court, to begin our day with prayer and singing. We mostly prayed out loud and sang hymns because by that time, the Baptist had overpowered the Quakers' silence. Sometimes we sang funny songs. The song I remember most clearly in those days of my relative, in these days of my relative decrepitude, was called "Do Your Ears Hang Low?" See? And it went like this. Do your ears hang low? Do they wobble to and fro? Can you tie them in a knot? Can you tie them in a bow? Can you throw them o'er your shoulder like a cotton-picking soldier? Do your ears hang low? You're not doing so well. At 8 o'clock, half the congregation were doing these little things. So, you know, we sang this song standing up and accompanied by motions, ear tugging and knot tying and bow tying and over the shoulder throwing and cotton picking, which we all knew how to imitate because at one time or another we had all picked at least a little bit of cotton. The reason I tell this story is, yes, to offer a little autobiographical levity into this sacred space this morning, but also because this remembered little ditty and its accompanying story reminded me several times this past week that joy may come in the morning. What I mean is that several times this week, while contemplating my morning visage in the mirror, something no one should ever have to do, I noticed that my ears were indeed hanging low. That they had, over the years, indeed developed a propensity to wobble to and fro. And most remarkable, if I looked closely, they were quite different one from the other. That made me think again about the remarkable fact that we humans are pretty much, from the fertilized egg on, asymmetrical creatures. Complicated in many ways, formed in a kind of miracle of evolution and happenstance, and landed in the world not only different from one another, but containing all manner of difference and opposition and complication and complexity in and of ourselves. Each of us is a kind of cosmos all by itself. And so it is with the human community and the community of faith which calls us here this morning. And as I was contemplating earlobes and asymmetry and fault choices, I thought of how frequently we humans devolve into camps which are framed as oppositional. We live in an either-or, yes-no world, in which choices are proffered in pairs and complexity is scorned. That we ourselves are in some measure responsible for this situation, the present situation of our world and of this country, whose beginnings we celebrate tomorrow, means that we are partly responsible for finding ways out of it and beyond it, while there is still time. One of my favorite writers is the very wise and very deep Ursula Le Guin, whose great novel, The Left Hand of Darkness, I read in my youth and have come back to often. In it, worlds of great darkness are created, and the task becomes finding ways to deal with the darkness. Here's what she says about that task in words that have decorated every desk I've ever sat at. She says, to oppose something is to maintain it. To oppose vulgarity is inevitably to be vulgar. You must have another goal. Then you will walk a different road. To learn, she says, which questions are unanswerable and not to answer them. This skill is most needful in times of stress and of darkness. Last week, Aunt Alexis left us with a great task, a task she at the end placed with great passion in God's hands and in the certainty of God's grace in every kind of darkness in which we must sometimes abide. It is true that the times are dark. It is true that the most powerful people now in our nation, our highest judges, seem hell-bent on crushing any spirit and any life of any vulnerable human being in the nation in the name of some unbridled notion of liberty that even, I think, our nation's incredibly flawed founders would have found bizarre. At the same time, I've been with you here for 7 rich and full weeks. It feels sort of like a lifetime, a good one. I've found in the conversations I've had with many of you a good deal of personal and spiritual darkness. We all have seasons of darkness, and sometimes of great darkness. My counsel to you and to this amazingly ready, ripe community is to practice living as fully as possible into your individual and collective griefs and bereavements, to allow yourselves to fully inhabit them, and at the same time, by doing that, to allow the possibility that the Holy One, that thing we call God and whom we Christians name and claim as Jesus, is sitting with us in those places, in this place, with you, with us. Indeed, Isaiah today, likening the Holy One to a mother, assures us that as a mother comforts her child, so I will comfort you. You shall be comforted in Jerusalem. You shall see, and your heart shall rejoice. Your bodies shall flourish like the grass. And so it shall be. And remember that Isaiah spoke that into a part of the world that was in his time very much like Ukraine is today. A nation, a territory, a history, a people devastated, destroyed by war and powerful conquering enemies. And yet, your bodies shall flourish like the grass, and it shall be. Paul, today, is back with the Galatians, worried as only Paul can be, as only he can be, about the well-being of this querulous, quarrelsome little community who are forever coming at one another with claims of superior virtue and righteousness and fuller claims on God's grace and mercy than their sisters and brothers. Those early Christians, earlier even than the name we give them, give ourselves, even then They were captured by a kind of either this or that world. Now, I think Paul's words today, those words we heard, are worth parsing deeply and interrogating carefully and perhaps even skeptically. There's a whole sermon in there about flesh. I'm not going to preach it, but it's there. But he has one sure thing to tell us today as we sit in flux and in our grief and in our uncertainty. And that, I believe, is very good advice. So then, Paul says, whenever we have an opportunity, let us work for the good of all, especially for those of the family of faith. In this case, on this morning, you are that family of faith. Work for the good of all. That means working to be a place where all are gathered in God's arms, in grief and in joy, black and brown and white and male and female and all the mysterious permutations of human gender and gender expression, in all the wondrous ways in which we are not one thing or another, but a glorious cacophony whose refrain is God's call to us, rejoice. And that also means working to become a place where words do matter, where no one must code switch to belong, where no ancient language is or will be a barrier to fully accessing the wonder of this God's community of grace and glory, where when words or old customs or habits inhibit access to the community, they are changed, and by changing, provide more welcome, more invitation, more of God's holy space for every one of God's creatures. And a final gospel word. We cannot, you cannot, do this work alone. Jesus sends us into the world at the very least two by two. And Le Guin's counsel is echoed in the words of our Savior today, do not tarry in places where you are opposed. Continue on, embracing the marvelous, incomprehensible, utterly complex, and often chaotic cosmos, which is actually just a fraction of God's dominion. As we begin to travel into and inhabit together that cosmic reality, we will find the only words that human beings have ever had for that endeavor. The words that in all human experience have said the name of the Holy most clearly, the name of love, and in that love, joy. And in that love and joy, and in that community of love and joy, all things are possible. Last week, in the vestry prayer, we heard from the great French priest and philosopher and paleontologist, Teilhard. With wisdom about living in times of uncertainty and flux. So let me leave you today with more Teilhard, a gospel claim that is foundational in my own life and faith, and perhaps maybe in yours too. The day will come, he says, the day will come when, after harnessing the ether, the tides, and gravitation, we shall harness for God the energies of love. And on that day, for the second time in the history of the world, humanity will have discovered fire. Let us walk, my friends, hand in hand, with open hearts and spirits full of joy, into that great work to which we are called. Amen. I think maybe we should not applaud. It'll get to be a contest. And there's no better preacher in this room than that one right there. So let me just say. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father, who with the Father and the Son is worshiped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
In peace, we pray to you, O God. For all people in their daily life and work, for our families, friends, and neighbors, and for those who are alone, for this community, the nation, and the world, for all who work for justice, freedom, and peace, for the just and proper use of your creation, for the victims of hunger, fear, injustice, and oppression, for all who are in danger, sorrow, or any kind of trouble, for those who minister to the sick, the friendless, and the needy, for the peace and unity of the Church of God, for all who proclaim the gospel and all who seek the truth, for Michael, our presiding bishop, and Daniel, our bishop, for Jim, our priest, Carol, our deacon, and Anne Alexis, our minister for children and youth, and for all bishops and other ministers, for all who serve God in the church.
We pray for the special needs and concerns of this congregation. Claire Concilio, Lynn Fulton, Victoria Hollerman, David, Barbara Baumgartner, Barbara, Jenny Dundon, Taylor Anderson, Carol Pomplin, George, Pete Davis, Harold Freeman, Barb, Jonas Brackus and Anthony, Barbara Benson and family, Bakari Henderson and family, Amy, Clara, Dimitro Johnson, Brian Regley, Elliot, Jean Patterson, Bert Zug, Sharon, Ann Brewster, David Collins, Astrid, Marvin Weisbord, Sarah Pearson, the children of Thornton David Savage and his wife Flora, and for those we name now, George, James. Hear us, Lord, for your mercy is great. We thank you, O God, for all the blessings of this life. We will exalt you, O God, our Savior, and praise your name forever and ever. We pray for all those who have died, that they may have a place in your eternal dominion. O Christ, let your loving kindness be upon them who put their trust in you. Christ, our God, accept the fervent prayers of your people. In the multitude of your mercies, look with the compassion upon us and all who turn to you for help. For you are gracious, O lover of souls, and to you we give glory. Forever and ever. Amen. Let us all join in saying the transition prayer found at the bottom of page 11 in your leaflet. Please join together. Assist us, O God, in living hopefully into the future. In the face of change, help us set unnecessary fears aside and to recognize our potential for creative response. Help us to develop a reasonable optimism when confronted by the new and to guard against our own defenses. Be with us as we remember and celebrate former times, and keep us from unreasonably yearning for them, which takes us from the work you have set before us in our time. All this we ask in the name of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Sinned against you in opposing your will in our lives. You have denied your goodness in each other, ourselves, and in the world. We repent of the evil that enslaves us, the evil we have done, and the evil done on our behalf. Forgive, restore, and strengthen us through our Savior Jesus Christ, that we may abide in your love and serve only your will. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Savior Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen.
Amen.
May the peace and love and joy of Christ be always with you.
And also with you.
Exchange that carefully, but, you know, heartily. So two things at this point I'm to tell you. One is that you are all, every human being is welcome at the table of God here at St. Martin's. There are gluten-free little wafers if you are a gluten-free person. All we ask is that you do not dip the wafer into the wine and get your fingers in there with it and mess up the cup. So don't do that. But otherwise, everyone is welcome at this table. Secondly, I am encouraged to encourage you to give into this community, which gives itself so much into the world. But without your giving into it, that cannot happen. So this is a time for that. And if you've already done it, do it some more. There's never such a thing as too much giving in every way possible. Walk, therefore, in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and sacrifice to God. May God be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to Christ our God. We praise you and we bless you, holy and gracious God, source of life abundant. From before time you made ready the creation. Your Spirit moved over the deep and brought all things into being, sun, moon, and stars, earth, winds, and waters, and every living thing. You made us in your image and taught us to walk in your ways, but we rebelled against you and wandered far away. And yet, as we care for our children, you would not forget us. Time and again, you called us to live in the fullness of your love. And so on this day, we join with saints and angels in the chorus of praise that rings through eternity, lifting our voices to magnify you as we say, Holy, Holy, Holy One, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed are they who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Glory and honor and praise to you, holy and living God, to deliver us from the power of sin and death and to reveal the riches of your grace. You looked with favor upon Mary that she might conceive and bear a son, Jesus, the Holy Child of God. Living among us, Jesus loved us. He broke bread with outcasts and sinners, healed the sick, and proclaimed good news to the poor. He yearned to draw all the world to himself, yet we were heedless of his call to walk in love. Then the time came for him to complete upon the cross the sacrifice of his life and to be glorified by you. On the night before he died for us, Jesus was at table with his friends. He took bread, gave thanks to you, broke it, and gave it to them and said, Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me. As supper was ending, Jesus took the cup of wine. Again, he gave thanks to you, gave it to them, and said, Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me. Now, gathered at your table, O God of all creation, and remembering Christ crucified and risen, who was and is to come, we offer to you our gifts of bread and wine and ourselves a living sacrifice. Pour out your Spirit upon these gifts that they may be the body and blood of Christ. Breathe your Spirit over the whole earth and make us your new creation, the body of Christ given for the world you have made. In the fullness of time, bring us with Mary and Martin and all your saints from every tribe and language and people and nation to feast at the banquet prepared from the foundation of the world. Through Christ and with Christ and in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, to you be honor, glory, and praise forever and ever. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. The gifts of God's love for God's loving people. Body of Christ, the bread of heaven. Body of Christ, the bread of heaven. Body of Christ, the bread of heaven. The body of Christ, the bread of heaven.
Let us pray. God of abundance, you fed us with bread of life and cup of salvation. You've united us with Christ and one another, and you've made us one with all your people in heaven and on earth. Now send us forth in the power of your Spirit, that we may proclaim your redeeming love to the world and continue forever in the risen life of Christ our Savior. Amen. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his risen Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and the blessing of God Almighty, our Creator, our Redeemer, our Sustainer, holy breath in this holy space, be with you now and remain with you forevermore. Amen. Have a seat. So very few announcements. There are a few printed in your leaflet. You can take them and read them at your leisure and attend to them as you like. I do, if you want to applaud, though, this would be a good time to do it. I want to thank Andrew Monath for playing the organ today. Andrew. Andrew stepped in very timely way in a tough week to help us out and did brilliantly. So thank you, Andrew. There is one more opportunity past the end of June for you to contribute to the Guatemala Scholarship Fund here in this space. And Terry has a clipboard. There's another one back in the back. You can always pledge online, but we need a couple more $1,000 to get where we need to be. So today would be the day to step up and get that done. So please do if you can. It's such an important and powerful ministry of this parish and this community into a community with whom you have connected so powerfully over the years. So let's keep that going. And then all the rest of the announcements are there for you to read. You won't have to listen to me do them. I hope you have a wonderful day tomorrow in whatever ways you're going to do. I heard one person say hot dogs. So whatever it is you're chowing down on, I hope it's with people you love and people who love you. Okay, anything else? All right, we'll sing our last hymn.